Dear colleagues, good morning. Since the majority of our participants are English speaking, I will switch to English.
We start our discussion on sustainable development, and it's very interesting that we start the Gaidar Forum for us from such a most global and most important topic. We all know how it was developed. I'm not sure we all know what exactly it is about. The discussion started in 1960s. It followed by the report of the Brundtland Commission that was named Our Common Future. The report was issued in 1987. The report provided us the definition of sustainable development, the most common definition, which is the development that meets the needs of the present without compromising the ability of future generations to meet their own needs. It was followed by Rio Plus 20 conference in 2012, then UN agreement on 17 sustainable development goals with 169 targets in 2015. Then Paris Agreement, which was not so ambitious, but it is certainly a defeat of the climate skeptics. So what we have now is that sustainable development is an issue that brought together the great global issues from poverty and hunger to health, education, water, clean energy, science and technology, and climate. It is very broad, it is very interesting agenda, it is very important. And today, at our panel, we have the top global policymakers, corporate leaders, and the top experts, and we try to discuss and look forward what must be done and what can be done on sustainable development. And my first question is to Jeffrey Sachs, the special advisor to the Secretary General of the United Nations and director of the Earth Institute at Columbia University. So what is sustainable development and what can we do to reach the sustainable development goals? Yes, please.
Good morning, everybody. Pavel, thank you very much. I'm really delighted to be here and delighted that the Gaidar Forum is opening with this very important topic. As our moderator has just indicated, sustainable development has become the cornerstone of the global idea of what development should be. And all 193 UN member states in 2015 gave a more explicit definition to sustainable development to make it more useful. And the way that sustainable development is conceived now is that every country should have three basic objectives in mind when it thinks about its development strategy. One dimension, of course, is economic development, continued progress in the material conditions of life. The second dimension is the social dimension, that there should be inclusion, a reduction of high income inequality, gender equality of men and women, and the removal of discrimination against minority groups, for example. And the third dimension is the environmental dimension, meaning that we should address the crises of biodiversity or the massive forest fires here or the big droughts that the US is experiencing or the climate change problems. So the idea that the governments of the world agreed to was to say three objectives: economic, social, and environmental. And I think very usefully, all the governments agreed on 17 broad goals, the sustainable development goals. And they have this famous, iconic picture, and when you walked in the building today, you could see the sustainable development goals in the hallway. I travel all over the world on behalf of the Secretary General of the UN. Any government building you walk into around the world, it's got this picture, basically. And that's because every government has signed on to achieve the Sustainable Development Goals. Of course, signing a document and actually taking it seriously are two very different things. Taking it seriously and achieving it are also two different things. And so there's a big gap between a document and reality. But I think that it's quite worthwhile for every country to ask the question, would we be better off achieving these sustainable development goals? In the United States, for example, next week I'm launching a book, a little book which says why the United States needs the sustainable development goals, because we're a kind of a mess. Our social conditions are terrible. Income inequality is very high. There's a tremendous social exclusion. We see it in health crises and in many other areas. And our environmental policies are also very confused. So while the United States is quite rich on the economic dimension, it's really quite lost on the social and the environmental dimension. And therefore, these goals are really helpful to calibrate for my country, for example, what would be a more balanced approach for development. Whether our government listens to this or not, I don't know. But I think that the importance of these goals for my own country, for example, is very high, and I would say the same is true for Russia. One of the things that the team that I lead for the UN Secretary General has done, and Mr. Guido Schmidt-Traub is the executive director of this team called the UN Sustainable Development Solutions Network, is to measure for every country as best we can where does the country stand on achieving these 17 goals right now. It's not a forecast of the future, it's just the initial conditions. So we did that for about 150 countries, and I'll just tell you what we found for Russia and what the analysis suggests for the priorities for Russia. Overall, Russia came out 47th out of 149 countries in terms of the progress towards the Sustainable Development Goals. Pretty good, but obviously room for improvement. The United States comes out somewhere in the 20s out of 149 countries. So the same story, okay, but not where you would really like to be. So what did we find for Russia? This is a diagram that in a short, simple way shows for the 17 sustainable development goals around the circle, the more the space is filled, the better the accomplishment. So SDG 1, which is end extreme poverty, Russia has fulfilled that. This is a country that doesn't have extreme poverty. And on many of the economic goals, the situation is pretty good, that Russia has done or is in a situation quite adequate. But on other of the goals, the situation is far from adequate. And this is the purpose of this kind of analysis. So we summarize the results by a kind of dashboard, looking at those 17 goals according to a green, yellow, and red criterion. In our report, we are quite tough graders. I think that's the prerogative of a professor for the last 37 years. I'm a pretty tough grader. So it doesn't mean disaster to have a red, but it means that there is work to do. So this is Russia's dashboard. SDG 1 is end extreme poverty. That's green. That's not a big issue here. hunger not a major issue on nutrition or agriculture, though there are a couple of issues. Education, also a yellow. Good, room for improvement. Energy, jobs, infrastructure, okay. Where we see the bigger challenges in the Russian context is not so different from the US, actually. The red squares are more the social dimensions and the environmental dimensions. So the social dimensions of the SDGs include SDG number 5, which is gender equality, and Russia gets a red there. And the reason is that the proportion of the Duma that is women is very low. So this, I think, is an issue of governance. We have almost the same low score in the United States, by the way. My view is more women in government, better government. So that's just my own view of that. SDG 10 is inequality. Russia has a rather high degree of inequality. By the way, almost exactly the same inequality score as the United States, a Gini coefficient of 0.4, which for high-income countries like Russia and the United States is not so good, compared, say, with the Scandinavian countries, which have a Gini coefficient of 0.25. And then goals 13, 14, 15 are environmental objectives. And Russia does not score too high on those. It's very much, again, like the United States, in fact. So I won't go into the details, but you know there's a lot of forest fires, a lot of threats to biodiversity in Russia, and this shows up in our index. Now, my view is that it would be quite useful for every government to state clearly, first, we will achieve the Sustainable Development Goals by 2030. Second, this is what we mean. These are our quantitative targets. And I'm going to try to promote that in the US context in the coming months. And here are just some examples where I think Russia could say, here are the Sustainable Development Goals, here is where we score low right now, and here is where we aim to be quantitatively in the year 2030. So just to mention them very quickly, SDG 3 is about health. We know that Russia continues to have a health crisis, especially for middle-aged men, and that means that the life expectancy is lower than it should be by really a gap of 15 years compared to other high-income countries. And I would try to state a goal for improvement of public health in Russia and work towards it. Second, I mentioned women in parliament. I'd like to see more women in the Duma and more women in the US Congress, and that is SDG 5. SDG 10 is the Gini coefficient. I think both Russia and the United States should aim to reduce the Gini coefficient from 0.4 to around 0.3 over a 15-year period by specific measures to improve the ability of poor households to enter the middle class and so forth. SDG 13 is about climate change. Every country needs to reduce its carbon emissions. And putting quantitative goals on that, of course, is quite important. SDGs 14 and 15 are about protecting the marine and the terrestrial ecosystems. And Russia, of course, with its vast, vast land area and its vast coastal regions, should be doing more to protect the ecosystems and the biodiversity, which are under threat. SDG 16 is about peaceful societies. Unfortunately, again, Russia and the United States look a lot alike in this.
homicide rates are very high. That's one of the indicators for the Sustainable Development Goals. I would try to pick a quantitative target to reduce the amount of violence within the society. Heaven knows for the United States, this is extremely important. And then finally, SDG 17 is about global cooperation. Every country, in my opinion, every high-income country, should be a donor country to be helping the poorest countries get out of their mess. And so Russia is one of the world's developed economies, and therefore I suggest for SDG 17 a target for development aid by Russia for other countries in the world. Russia gives a lot of aid, but putting it as official development assistance with a clear target, I think would be quite useful. So this is just to summarize, and I'll sit down. The SDGs will be useful only if they're used in two specific ways. One is that each country looks at them and says, you know, that's helpful. This is useful for our own idea of what a good society should look like. Second, that these are used as specific quantitative tools to say, here is where we want to be in 13 years from now, in 2030. Here are the policy steps that we could use to get there, and then to monitor the progress year by year. The project that I lead for UN Secretary General Antonio Guterres will be monitoring this progress year by year, and I hope that Russia and every other country will say, these are our goals, these are our metrics, we'll be watching them, and if this is done, I believe that this globally agreed tool could be very, very useful for helping us get to a better world. Thank you very much.
Thank you very much, Dr. Sachs, for a very structured overview and the examples of where Russia is. Let me now turn to our main policy speaker, Tarja Halonen, the President of Finland for 12 years from 2000 to 2012. And Madam President now holds a key global position as a co-chair of high-level panel on global sustainability of UN Secretary General. And my question to Madam President is, what are the policy challenges to long-term development? What is the level of this agenda? Is it global? Is it national? How it should be implemented?
If you want to get my brief answer, it's both and. But if you accept me to say a little bit longer, I will say that it was a good idea that Jeffrey started this. I tell first one of the secrets, what you might noticed already. We are the members of the same team, the same gang, because I belong also to this panel, and then we are working also together with IIASA, Institute of which is specialized for the of these researches which are concerning how to make this sustainable development ready. And so I think that you will hear also Pavel Kabel and also the Guido Schmidt-Traub to speak about that. And when I say that this is national and this is international, this is global, I make this picture even a little bit more difficult for you, because I was working already as a co-chairman for the Millennium Goals in 2000. I remember how the people took us. They said like me that, okay, Tarja, with your blue eyes, it's nice to try to make your world better, but you will not make a good success. And we made it. As you know, we have made a half of the extreme poverty, and we have made a lot of other things. So you have to have a very, very challenging goals in order to get a good result, but also be prepared to work very hard. And what we learned from the MDGs is that strong, committed governments are very, very important, but you have to push them a little bit all the time. With MDGs, we waited a little bit for little bit for too long time, and then we were very much hurry up in the end of the of this period. But now this is not enough, because if we see those goals what Geoffrey already showed to you, for instance, there is a decent work. In the vast majority of the UN member countries, the governments cannot do this part of the decent work alone. But because we have more or less a market economy in all countries, so we need also the business community to be with us, and that's why it's fantastic we have this Coca-Cola as a good example of the big enterprise to be with us. Then the third point, many of you are guilty for the activities, guilty, I would say the responsible, and I'm happy that you are welcome, in NGO activities. So we need also NGOs. Then we need also academia, like Geoffrey is from the Columbia University, as a main work. So that's all what we need, different kind of the actors. And this is also the challenge for you, because you can, in UN meeting, you can always say to the governments that you have not done enough, and we will do that. But how to put the NGOs and business community and university to go to the same direction? And when we say that this is a national and international and global, so as a matter of fact, we have also to strengthen the networks of the business community, to strengthen the networks of the academia, to strengthen the networks of the NGOs. But the good side is that we have done that quite a lot already. So in that way, this is one of the challenges in process way, that not only one actor or these 193 UN member countries, but we have to take also all these sectors of the society and try to push somehow them to the same direction. My friends here, they know that I sometimes trying to describe it, I say that this is a certain kind of the ecoplasma. You see that like a jelly that you don't know how to handle, but you have to anyway, like in physics or in chemistry, you try to create the process where you know that now they are going to the same direction. That's part one. And I hope you will ask something about the gender, because this is the part of my heart.
Thank you very much, Madam President. Should we continue with a question on gender? Or...
Yeah, okay, because I think that that's one of the best victories we have done.
If you allow me, just one word. When we seen the scoreboard that Jeffrey Sachs told us, the gender was red in Russia, and he was mentioned why. It's a little bit biased estimate, of course, and we can discuss the gender issue, but what aspects are important? What issues should be addressed?
So I think that one important thing is that it's a question of the fair play concerning the human rights. Everybody will say that, of course, we are very, very equal. And here, there are quite much women and men, yeah, not quite balanced, but pretty good. In many other countries, it wouldn't be so good. But the reasons are also, one is the human rights level, of course, what we have worked already for 60 years. But the second point, what we have noticed in the Nordic countries, is that when you are supporting stronger gender equality, it will give also benefits for the whole society. So that you will see it in GDP also. We have done it already, and we know that it happens in such a way. That's one thing. And if you think the global issue, so globally, a little bit more than half of the population of this planet, they are women. And so I think that it would be ridiculous if in any enterprise, corporation, you would say that we don't take half of the possible candidates to this job. The second point is that then not only the gender, but also the young people. A majority of the population of the planet will be, already now and in the near future, they will be young people. And so we educate them better, we have invested a lot in young people, and that's why it would be, of course, very, very practical that we also welcome them more strongly to come to part of the responsibility persons in that side. And this is, of course, the poor one is the third point what we noticed in SDGs, that which is, how could I say, if we classificate that which are the, those who are not represented enough, the poor people. But of course we want to get rid of the poor poverty, but we want to integrate the poor people also to the national processes and also in UN side. And so I think that when we are neighbors, the Russia and Finland, so of course you have noticed that Finland has survived pretty well, even we have a poor, perhaps because we have this gender equality. And we are ready to work as a neighborhood very well. And I know your Valentina Matvejko pretty well, so, and we meet her also today. So I mean that you have a good female politicians already, but could be more. The next point is, of course, that if we all think the Russia, USA, Finland, Germany, globally, so the worst or the biggest challenge is in the deep south. And I have promised to work with UN also with Every Woman, Every Child project, what was the one of the, how could I say, close to heart, to Ban Ki-moon's heart, and that was especially something what he wanted to bridge to the next Secretary General Antonio Guterres, who is very much he for she man, what's one of the projects in UN. In the deep south, if we think of, for instance, in Africa, the women are producing 80% of all work in agriculture. They are those who are responsible already today for the food security, food production. But the possibilities to have a property, the property rights, the possibilities for sexual and reproductive health and rights, and also the possibility to get an education and to get a finance, both by their own national resources, but also by the UN system, is not equal to the men. And so, of course, you will already say that that's stupid. We should, of course, specially encourage those who are already responsible for the food security to get all these means what they need. I also have underlined this human rights issue in the way that I have promised, and I have started to work with World Health Organization and the UN Human Rights Commission in the working group, where we try to show that the health and more, and even also the sexual and reproductive health and rights, they are part of the human rights issues, and then we will treat them for the World Health Organization in that way. So we have a lot of work doing already in the process. So that will go well. But last but not least, I will say that concerning the cooperation, what Jeffrey already took very well, is that, for instance, if we take the Arctic situation, Finland will have now the German position for the next years in that, and you are our neighbor. I mean, and we have the Arctic direction. Of course, we would like to get the good summers, but I think that the winters could be a little bit better. I mean, old time winters, because our fauna and our flora is used for the hard winters, and it has helped them to avoid the diseases. It's not only a question that how we feel to dress. And so one of the very good cooperation we have had concerning SDGs is the Baltic Sea issue, where we have, thanks for all of us, but also for the people in St. Petersburg who made the wastewater system. They have renewed it. They have taken, as they say, from the Tsar's time to the modern time, and now already the eastern part of the Baltic, or the Gulf of Finland, is much, much cleaner than what it used to be. But now we have to continue, because we have agriculture, we have all these problems. So I mean, in the matter of fact, I don't know, dear friends from Russia, whether you know that we are one of the positive examples, the Baltic Sea states, that how we have managed with our common sea. But it's not enough. We'll have to continue. And women have had also a role in that. Thank you.
Madam President mentioned the importance of involvement in the business sector, and I know that Clyde Tuggle needs to leave, but I can't let him go without a question on the Sustainable Development Goals 6, which addresses the availability and sustainable management of water. What Coca-Cola does globally on water use and replenishment and generally on sustainable development agenda, please, Clyde.
Great, very nice. Thank you, Pavel. It's great to be here today. I want to talk about the water issues specific to Coke and also specific to Russia, but just a quick word on sustainability as it relates to the philosophy of our business. You know, when you look at our business model and you look at the 17 sustainable development goals, those have to become the goals of a company like Coca-Cola. Because when you've got arguably the world's best known brand, there are two things that drive you into that space. One, it's all about economic growth. And if you fundamentally believe that these goals foster economic growth, and we do, then adhering to, believing in, fostering, finding ways to make these goals part of your business model are essential. And then the second piece is, it's all about the consumer. So if you're a business like ours that is a consumer-centric business, everything emanates from the consumer, then to the extent that our consumers are not just saying this is a nice to do, but quite frankly are demanding of businesses and brands that they participate in making these goals real, then that becomes part of how you build a brand. And so it's just natural. And then I think the final thing I'd say is that, you know, when you look at our business model the last 130 years as we've gone around the world now, 207 countries, and we've come in as a guest of countries like this great country, Russia, and we've unpacked our bags. The first question we've asked of the governments who have invited us in to be guests in these countries is not where are we going to put our plant. The first question we ask is what is it that we need to do to help your country become a more sustainable country, economically, socially, educationally, environmentally, et cetera. This is the first question we ask, because we understand that as that country goes, economically, environmentally, socially, politically, et cetera, so goes our business. And so I want to open the comment, and I want to talk about the water specific issues specifically. But I think it is important that, and I look at the recommendations that Dr. Sachs put up, I think every business in this country should make it incumbent upon themselves, whether you're a Russian business or a multinational like Coke, to say, what are we going to do? What role will we play to help achieve those goals? That is what it means to be a responsible business. And so at the end of the day, it's really about good stewardship, and the idea of sustainability and good stewardship are inextricably linked. Now, on to the point about water. There are four primary areas that we really play in when we look at sustainability and water. It's clean water and sanitation, and in that space, it breaks down into several areas. I want to point some of these out, and I want to give you some specific examples as it relates to our business here in Russia. The first would be water usage reduction. We have set a goal that our business globally will be water neutral. We set that goal originally for 2020. That means every liter of water that goes into the production of one of our products, we will return to the environment. We're pleased to say that by the end of this past year, we had achieve that goal. But here in Russia, we're also focused on reducing the amount of water we use per liter. Our system-wide water efficiency has improved 13 consecutive years globally, and over the past 5 years, we've improved our water use ratio by more than 30%, and we have put a goal in place by 2020 to improve the water efficiency of our operations another 25%. The other point I would make here is that this putting these goals, these measurable goals in place is essential. It's easy to sort of say I believe in this and I support that, but I think for businesses in particular, putting goals in place that are measurable is essential. Second point I would make in the water space is in the area of water replenishment. And we have a global goal to safely return to communities and nature an amount of water, as I said, equal to what we use in our beverages and their production. And the projects that we have focused on are really about where are there water-stressed areas. And so around the world, we've picked project and partners to invest in to say, where are the water-stressed areas? What can we do in terms of not just what we're pulling out of it, but then what are the projects that we can engage in? And I give you a couple of examples from here in Russia. There are three of them. In the Volga-Akhtyabr floodplain, there are three lakes in that floodplain, the Sotovo Lake, Lake Sazini, and the Zaporonoya Lake. All of those have come under severe stress by ecosystems. And we have, in partnership with WWF here in Russia and the Russian Federation, and at a subnational basis, have elected to engage in and invest in preserving those territories. So, you know, improving safe access to water and sanitation, protecting watersheds, providing water for productive use, and then really educating and raising awareness about water issues, including the engagement on water policy. These are the fundamentals where we feel like we can play and make a difference. Final point I'll make, and whether it's in the space of water, and I want to play off of the comments from Madam President, at the end of the day, this cannot be done by government alone. It cannot be done by business alone. It is going to require an unprecedented level of cooperation between the civil society, business, and government. We refer to this oftentimes as the Golden Triangle. And I think at the end of the day, a business like Coca-Cola, who is here for the long term, and in a place like Russia that's committed to building a business that is truly a Russian business, we are, as I said earlier, linked to inextricably the success and the sustainability of this great country. And it starts and ends with agreeing where we can play and what can we do and how can we measure it. And we're proud to be a part of the history of this great country, and we're also proud to be a part of the future. Thank you.
Thank you very much, Clyde. And let's continue with the business discussion. And I address my next question to Paul Polman, the CEO of Unilever Group. And the question is the same, actually, what is the role of business? But I stress out one thing. The sustainable development goals, do they coincide with business goals, or is just additional costs and something that is not necessary? Please, Paul.
I'll just use the podium a little bit. What I wanted to do is build on Jeffrey's overall framing, if you don't mind, and then Glide's specific example to put it in the context a little bit more of the broader business community. I had the fortune to be on the high-level panel from the private sector helping develop the Sustainable Development Goals, and like with Jeffrey, we're currently still very actively SDG advocates. So the question really that we should be answering is, why should the broader business community get involved in these Sustainable Development Goals? And if so, what should they be doing to get involved? And you have seen already from Clyde's example and the wonderful leadership that Coca-Cola is showing that it actually makes good business sense. But how do we get at that scale? So let me pick up where Jeffrey left it off and make clear that over the last 30 years or so, we've seen enormous progress in the global wealth. There's nothing to be said about. We have more people access to water, more women in education, child mortality is down, more people have been lifted out of poverty with the Millennial Development Goals. It's actually a very good time to be born. You'd be having a higher chance to be educated, access to medical care, living longer. It's a good wealth. So let's not start from a discussion of negativism here. The GDP in the last 50 years has multiplied by a factor of 5, population by 3 times, definitely 500 million people out of the poverty, defined in the Millennial Development Goals as $1.25 a day. Now it's $1.90. We have done a tremendous job. But I think it has become clear to more and more people, fortunately, especially since the financial crisis we've had in 2007, 2008, that there are serious flaws in our economic system. And these flaws are starting to show up more and more. And some of these flaws you should be familiar with, and in fact the scorecard again once more of Jeffrey talks about these things. Natural disasters are costing us now 5 trillion more than the normal weather pattern we've been on. Violence and armed conflicts in this world, you read it every day in the papers, is now absorbing a cost equivalent to 9% of the global GDP. Biodiversity and ecosystems are being challenged to the tune already today of 3% of GDP, and if we don't do anything in the next 20 to 30 years, that could easily approach the 8 to 10%. And then the World Bank has estimated if we don't attack more aggressively the disastrous effects of runaway climate change, we will push over 100 million people more into poverty. And I certainly wouldn't want to be part of that. Jeffrey has talked about the Gini coefficient. Unfortunately, this is a world that we live in now where 1% of the world population has the same net wealth of the 99 other percents. And frankly, the 99 other percents are not accepting this anymore. Social inequality has become a very big issue. Any system, I believe, where too many people feel that they're not participating, where too many people feel that they're left behind, will ultimately rebel against itself. And in fact, what you now see with the angst that you see of globalization, the angst of technology coming in, the angst, thanks to transparency of the internet, etc., where many people feel that the deck is stacked against them, if you want to, we see enormous voices coming up of the population in the Brexit vote in the UK, in the US elections, in the upcoming elections in my own country, in the Netherlands. People are starting to speak out. If we don't change the system, they will probably start changing it for us, and it won't be as pretty, in my opinion. And you start to see the effects of that already. So we have to take action. We have to take action very simply, because in a business of enduring poverty, there really isn't any business case. If you look at companies like Coca-Cola or a company that I represent, our business tends to do well in economies that do well, and our business tends to do poorly in economies that do poorly. And unfortunately, of the latter, we have too many in this world. Now, the business doesn't like this enormous insecurity that we're currently sitting on. Governments are paralyzed, going back to nationalism, populism, and frankly not addressing the global challenges that need to be addressed. And in this environment of uncertainty, investments are not being made. If you don't believe me, just look at the US. In the last 2 years, the amount of money that has corporate America has been spent on share buybacks or dividends, actually for the first time in history, exceeds retained earnings. No wonder the economies don't grow. No wonder we don't create the jobs. We have to get back to the real economies. Now that requires quite a fundamental change in the economic system, and that's a challenge for politicians. Hence, the responsibility of business and other partners of society to help de-risk that political process. We certainly need a change in our economic system to be able to operate within the planetary boundaries. We need a change in our economic system to make the financial system work for the sustainable economy, not for just a few people. We need a change in our economic system to redefine our social contract so that we don't leave people behind. And I believe, why I'm so enthusiastic, that in the absence of governments being able to help us with the global goals and regulations, in 2015, 193 countries did rise to the challenge and agreed the Sustainable Development Goals. I believe it's probably the best moral compass we have on how we should rule this world now and for generations to come. But I also believe it probably is the biggest opportunity that we have for everybody business included. And the world seems to be serious, because only a few months after Paris, we signed the climate change agreement, goal number 13. And probably one of the things that permeates everything. There is no human development if we don't tackle the issue of climate change. In fact, they are two sides of the same coin, as far as I'm concerned. Now, business has to be involved. Very simple. The cost of implementing the Sustainable Development Agenda is estimated to be between $2 and $4 trillion a year. Sounds a lot to all of us, but we are talking only 2 to 4% of the global economy. The reality is that overseas development aid of all the governments, with all their good intentions combined, is only $160 billion. $2 to $4 trillion, $160 billion. We do need the private sector. We do need the private sector to unlock, obviously, the financial side of it. On top of that, to provide the innovations that are needed, to create the jobs that everybody is desperately looking for. And it's a very attractive proposition. At the world, at the moment in the world that we're running out of monetary policy tools in many parts of the countries, where fiscal policy becomes more difficult to implement in many of the countries in the world, and frankly, where governments are afraid to make the structural reforms needed, at the risk, increasingly so, of not getting re-elected, we have here a wonderful plan for economic growth, for inclusion, that probably has some of the highest payouts that we've ever seen in the business community. $1 invested in nutrition in this world gives a $17 return for society. $1 invested in sanitation, simply providing water, clean water, or toilets to people, has a $10 return for society. In fact, as the Honorable Prime Minister of Finland mentioned, investing in women, giving them the same access to education, land rights, and financing could lift the global economy up by up to $28 trillion. We are at a moment that the cost of not acting is actually becoming higher than the cost of acting. 9% for conflicts and wars, only 2 to 4% for implementing the sustainable agenda. As a businessman, as a father, as a human being, I know what I would pick. So why isn't business getting more involved right now? Obviously, there's a question of awareness. 17 goals, 169 targets, developed by the UN, somewhere far away, it looks like in a big building. It can be overwhelming. It can be overwhelming at a time that you have to deal with economic pressures and have the shareholder pressures and asking yourself every day the question even of, will I survive as a business the next day? The second reason that I think not enough businesses are getting involved is that they feel that it's the job of governments. Somehow we have created the silos in society. Many governments think that they are there to regulate and tell business what to do. Many businesses think that the best they can do is stay on the right side of the law, but it had only brought us so far. If we really want to develop this agenda, we have to work differently, we have to work at a different level. It actually is captured in goal number 17. Goal number 17 is about partnership, as many of you know. But it's not just partnership of you are my supplier or I am delivering my products to you. No, it's a partnership with society. It's a partnership for the common good. It's an intergenerational partnership. It's a partnership of morality. It's a partnership where we put the interest of others ahead of our own, knowing darn well that by doing so, we all would be better off. It is a partnership for peace, prosperity, people, planet. Absolutely key. And it requires business to do this, and business to be an active part of that. Now, the business case is overwhelming. It drives efficiency gains. It takes costs out of the system. It builds reputation. It allows you to attract the right talents. And more importantly, over time, it secures you a license to operate. At a time that the average lifetime of a company has significantly decreased from over 60 years, about 50 years ago, to only 17 years now, many companies ought to ask themselves the question, how can I stay around a little bit longer? And the answer to me is hard work, but very simple. Don't be so myopically focused on the shareholders be increasingly focused on serving society. Go back to the original purpose of business. If you serve society and positively address some of these issues that are out there, society will accept you. And if you do that well, you have a long-term existence that also will be to the benefit of your shareholders. And we certainly see that in our company. Now, not surprisingly, 9,000 companies have signed up to the Sustainable Development Goals via the UN Global Compact. 35,000 companies are involved in efforts to decarbonize with the World Business Council for Sustainable Development. The SDSN network that Jeffrey and Guido lead have an enormous amount of pickup from the private sector as well. Momentum is starting to build. People see that the opportunities of acting and being part of this is enormous. So what does it take to get everybody involved, to have that critical mass, to get to these tipping points that really will change the world versus the anecdotal stories of individual companies? I think there are six major points that I just wanted to touch on, and I'll be very brief for the interest of time. The first one is for companies actually to be aware of the global goals. We've created this Commission of Business and Sustainable Development under the leadership of Mark Malik Brown to be able to reach about 1,000 of the biggest companies and CEOs in this world, explain to them the SDGs and why they could be absolutely crucial for their businesses. Number one is awareness. Number two, obviously, awareness isn't enough. You need engagement. So getting these Sustainable Development Goals integrated into your business. Which of these 17 goals are important to you? How are you going to institutionalize that into your company, drive it into your strategies? Be sure your board is supportive. Empowering your people that work for you. Servicing your consumers in the right way. An immense opportunity, by the way, not only to grow your business, the 12 trillion plus economic opportunity, but we estimate that if this is properly done, we could also generate 380 to 400 million additional jobs. And I tell you, the world will need additional jobs. The third one, and equally important, is that if you get your own house in order, are aware and put it in your value chains, put it in your own operations, you have to drive it into the value chain. You cannot do these things all alone. Often these value chains are sectorial. If you're in the food industry, work with all of the food companies to solve the issue of illegal deforestation. If you're in the food company, work with all the food companies to attack the still burning issues of food waste or absence of nutrition, still hitting 160 million children a year with stunting. Drive transformative change in your sector and then across sectors. Very, very powerful. And then, if you've done that, you have some examples to talk about, like Coke is talking about the impact they're having on changing the equation on water in this world. The fourth step that you then do is work with policymakers, what I call de-risking the political process. We have to get the right frameworks in place. There are many perverse policies still that actually provide this uncertainty for business not to invest. How do we put a price on carbon? How do we put structural policies in place that actually catalyze the business community towards these goals? Absolutely key. Then we need to have the financial system work. This is a world where we have $300 trillion of money floating around for a real economy of only $100 trillion. It's not surprising to me that in many places in the world the cost of money is zero or even negative. We have too much money in this world. There's no question about that. We just don't put it to good use. We have to get that money to be not dormant and zero interest rates, but we have to get them behind the projects of the Sustainable Development Goals. What does that require us? It requires different tools of financing, the blended financing that are coming in now, the green bonds, and many other things. It requires the regulatory reforms to be sure that that money arrives at the right place, and it requires the clear signals from governments that they're serious. Just the example of Paris. When the Paris Accord was signed in December 2015, the financial community woke up. All of a sudden they understood that the global governments in this world decided to decarbonize this global economy. And not surprisingly, the movement of divestiture actually picked up. At Paris, we thought we would get $500 billion of money under management divesting from carbon in their portfolio. We ended up to have $900 billion at the time of Paris. That amount has now moved up to $5 trillion. $24 trillion of money under management is asking for a price on carbon. When the signals are clear, the financials will be unlocked as well. And then last but not least, I think companies need to take a higher responsibility to build a new social contract with society. Goal number 16 is about governance, rules of law. No system can function if governments don't function. This is still a world where 4 billion people, and mainly women, I hate to say, don't even have access to legal systems. Corruption is prevalent. Companies provide a sport of not paying tax. Social compliance in the value chains are not being stuck to. We still live in a world where 150 million children are involved in the workforce. Child labor. And I'm talking between the ages of 5 and 12 here. I'm not even going higher. We still live in a world where we have 20 to 40 million refugees, often being abused in the value chains. And these numbers are also going up. Ladies and gentlemen, we simply have two alternatives. The first alternative is a simple one. Some of us decide to pick that. Let's do nothing. Let's make it someone else's problem. If we wait long enough, the problem will go away. It doesn't affect me anyway because I belong to the 1%. That is not going to lead to anything. In fact, it will only drive us down and at an accelerated pace. The other one is to say, I understand the definition of sustainability. I understand that we're here basically, just like Mrs. Brundtland said, as stewards to hand over to the next generations. I understand that the definition of greed, the definition of sustainability is when I put the interest of my children and their children ahead of my own personal greed. I see these enormous opportunities. I know we can change the economic system. And I want to be part of a generation that deals with the issues of climate change and once and for all solves these issues of poverty. No doubt that I want to be part of that group of people that fits in the last category. I hope you do. And that brings me to my final point. We know what we have to do. We have the means to do it. Frankly, we're here at the university. We don't need more PhDs, nor do we need to send more people to Mars or any other planet. What we need is human willpower, itself a renewable resource. And that requires leadership. We simply need more leaders that first and foremost are human beings, are highly aware of the issues that we have in this world, and are willing to engage with a certain level of humanity and humility, who are willing to work in partnership across these sectors, purpose-driven for the interest of the common good. And yes, are wanting to be part of restoring that trust that is badly damaged, and willing to work in transparency, being held accountable, and obviously become part of this movement to make this a better world for all. I thank you very much.
And thank you very much, Paul. Especially thank you for the motivation and responsible commitments that you showed to us. I would like to address my next question to Guido Schmidt-Traub, the Executive Director of UN Sustainable Development Solution Network, one of the networks that we've mentioned before. And I'd like to base on the two alternatives that Paul showed us in the end. And Paul didn't speak about the technological challenges and the demand of innovation that derives from difference with these alternatives. And what are the possible strategies, and does the strategies really drive technological challenges if we compare these two alternatives or these scenarios? Please, Guido.
Thank you very much, Pavel. If you don't mind, I'll also use the link. I think the role of technology is the central question.
The theme of this year's Gaidar Forum is about setting priorities for Russia and for the world. So it's very remarkable that the first session actually focuses on these long-term challenges. This is not what the newspapers say. This is not what a lot of day-to-day politics focuses on. And what they have in common is that we do need action. We do need action from the public and the private sector, but we do need it around a shared understanding of how to get to the long-term goals. Professor Sachs spoke about the importance of goals that need to translate into strategies and that then need to be implemented. And we have today gaps at the goal level, at the strategies, and of course at the implementation. And what is remarkable is that if you travel around the world, if you go to any G20 countries, the challenges indeed are very, very similar. Professor Sachs highlighted this with an analysis of Russia's challenges on the environmental and the social side. If you travel to China, if you go to Brazil, if you go to the United States, if you go to Europe, in fact, these issues are very, very similar, and I think that's something that we should also focus on in these challenging times. I want to address your question on the technology by focusing on two particular challenges. One is the energy transformation, the other one is what we call loosely the land use transformation, which both Clyde and Paul in particular have spoken to. In Paris, countries committed themselves, every country, Russia, every country in the world committed itself to staying within 2 degrees Celsius. That means that by 2070 at the latest, more likely 2050, net emissions of greenhouse gases have to fall to zero in every country. It's not about reducing them a little bit, they really have to fall to zero. Many countries are working on this, but no country is yet fully on track towards that. This means, of course, that we need to completely redesign the energy system in every country. We also need to redesign the way we use land use, and the land use challenge is particularly acute. It, of course, encompasses agriculture. We're in a world of 7.5 billion people today. We'll soon be 9 billion people by the middle of the century, rising to probably 11 billion by the end of the century. These people require more nutritious food. There's the first question of food production. That food production has to be sustainable because we only have a limited amount of water, and it has to be done without generating greenhouse gas emissions. So we also need to lower the emissions to zero by the middle of the century. And finally, the land use also has to take into account the biodiversity. We cannot continue destroying biodiversity at the pace that we're doing. So the triple challenges of food security, sustainable food production, the staying within local and global boundaries, the planetary boundaries, both on emissions and on water use and biodiversity, define the land use challenge. And that's, of course, the space where food companies like Unilever and Coca-Cola operate in. What is clear is that we cannot get there without business. Business have to lead these transformation, but it is equally clear that the market itself will not deliver on them. There aren't sufficient market signals, even price signals, if they existed fully, would not be sufficient to get to an energy system that generates the power that a country needs at a price that is competitive. So this, of course, has to be done whilst continuing and sustaining economic growth and increasing prosperity, shared prosperity. This simply cannot be done on a market alone approach. So what we need is, and Clyde and Paul spoke to this very eloquently, is we need public-private cooperation. And so I wanted to just focus, and this has to center in particular around the very difficult and challenging question of technology. In 2013, we got a group of the leading energy and climate institutes from around the world, including RANEPA and the Moscow School of Economics, together to look at what exists in countries right now on the energy transformation. And we asked a very simple question. We had 16 countries around the table, the 16 largest G20 emitters, and we asked, what do you have in your country by way of an analysis showing how your country could get towards net zero emissions by the early second half of this century? And what do you have in terms of analysis that is robust enough so you can engage your policymakers on them? And among the 16 countries, 13 said that they had nothing of the sort. And this included the United States of America, it included Australia, it included Japan, Brazil, China, and Russia. Only some European countries had the initial trappings of a pathway, of a strategy, of clarity of how to achieve this goal. And this, of course, 2 years before the Paris Climate Agreement was an untenable situation, because how can policymakers commit to 2 degrees Celsius if they don't understand what this means, what this looks like in their country? And we also realized that while there are lots of global analyses, there were strategies written about Russia by people outside Russia, there were analyses written for China by people outside China, that, of course, is not sufficient and will not shift the political and the policy discussion in the country. So there needs to be a Russian analysis written for the Russian public. So we got to work, and we're extremely proud to have achieved two sets of reports. The last one came out just before the climate conference in Paris, that not perfectly, but for the first time, spelt out how such a transformation might be achieved, focusing on the energy sector. And the good news is that there was a broad consensus after many difficult discussions. And initially, many people in the group from many countries thought that this was impossible. But in the end, after 2 years of hard work, we realized and we came to the shared conclusion that in every country, this transformation actually is not just necessary, but it is possible. And I want to share those lessons quickly. First, we learned on the energy side that really every energy system, of course, is very different. But we are talking about three shared challenges. The first one is massive improvements in energy efficiency. Space heating, industrial energy efficiency, transport, and this is where in every country, I would say particularly in Russia, there are tremendous opportunities, and this is, as Paul said, this is a bit of a no-brainer, because greater efficiency generates not only higher business returns, but also a higher efficiency of public investments. The second challenge is zero carbon power generation. So we need to generate electricity without generating greenhouse gas emissions. And this means a massive reduction in the dependency on fossil fuels. It doesn't mean ending the use of fossil fuels completely, because if we can capture the carbon dioxide that comes out of the fossil fuels then sequester it, then we can continue to use a modest proportion of fossil fuels. But on that, we realized that there really wasn't enough work underway to drive the core technologies of carbon capture sequestration. I think this is where particularly Russia, given the high dependency of the economy on fossil fuels, has a strong interest, and I think there is a need, not just a need, but also an opportunity to do much greater work on that. The third pillar of decarbonization is fuel switching. That means basically electrifying heating and buildings, electrifying transport, and of course electrifying by using zero carbon electricity. And so what we found is that every country has its own strategy. Some countries felt that nuclear power was an important part of the solution to mix. Other countries felt no nuclear power could under no circumstances be part of the solution. And these are of course questions which cannot and shouldn't be resolved at a global level. Every country needs to find the path that works in its setting, but it has to be consistent with the overall exam question, which is to get to zero emissions. The second lesson, this goes to the heart of your question, Pavel, is that the technologies basically exist, but we need much, much faster progress on improving them, bringing down the cost, and improving in particular the adoption of these technologies. This is a point made by many countries, in particular the large BRICS economies, India, China, others, who said we want to do this transition, but we do need better technologies that need to be affordable to us. And I think this is something that we'll probably talk about in the discussion also, where we do need to talk about international cooperation. How can we work together to bring battery-driven vehicles onto the roads at 100% penetration of new registration by 2030? How can we work on carbon capture storage? Because ultimately, the technologies are non-rival goods. They can be, once they exist, they can be used by everyone. And I think Russia, there are a few sectors where Russia has not only a strategic interest, but also very, very, very deep expertise and should consider, in cooperation with other G20 countries, playing a leading role on driving those technologies, because that's also going to be the economic future. That's where the future business opportunities will be generated. And this technology, driving the technologies needs to be done with the various industrial sectors, the various business sectors, as Clyde and Paul have said, is we need targeted discussion on how to drive the efficiency
and reduce the costs of key technologies. The third lesson is one of international diplomacy, because these challenges of an energy transformation are extremely complex and risky. No country has really done this yet. Some countries have made tremendous strides, but no country is yet on a home stretch. But everyone needs to do this. So how do we get from an equilibrium where few countries are doing it to one where everyone is doing this? And this requires trust. This requires trust in other countries' willingness and seriousness to actually undertake these transformations. And for that, these long-term strategies, these long-term pathways are an invaluable tool. Because if Chinese analysts see that the United States and Europe have a long-term pathway for the energy transformation that gets them to zero emissions, and if they get to see that the shorter-term strategies, the sort of shorter-term policies are consistent with that long-term goal, it'll be much easier to convince decision-makers in Beijing to also jump. And this holds for everyone. So that's what we need. We need these long-term pathways that need to be transparent. In that context, it's extremely important that the Paris Climate Agreement in Article 4.19 adopted the concept of long-term low-emission development strategies, they're called. It's basically a commitment by every country by 2020, at the latest, to put forward a long-term strategy. The US, Canada, and Mexico, and Germany have put forward their strategies at the climate conference in Marrakesh, and we very much hope that all G20 countries will jump at this opportunity and put forward their strategies way before 2020. Because we need the G20 countries to lead on this, and to use this as a confidence-building measure to move towards a much more fact-based and impartial discussion on the specific steps that need to be taken. A final point as to why these long-term strategies are so important is because they need to anchor the national debates. President Halonen spoke about the social challenges. The social challenges of an energy transition are also very deep. My country, Germany, is seeing this now because we'll need to phase out certain industries. Even though they might form a relatively small part of the economy, there is no future in lignite coal, certainly not in Germany. But this requires social change, which is difficult. And having an honest, fact-based, and transparent discussion around the need for long-term transformation and a clearer understanding of where difficult decisions need to be taken is absolutely critical to build the support for this. So this work, a lot of this work has been done on energy, and we at the Sustainable Development Solutions Network are pleased to have been a part of that. We are working actively with businesses and governments around the world to help improve these strategies. They all have to be done locally, so nobody writes a strategy for another country. And we look forward to continue working with our Russian friends on supporting the process in Russia. We're working with businesses around in key sectors to address the technology challenges, and we're now starting a major effort to look at the land use transformation, which is even more complex than the energy transformation. It requires more science, even though I'm sure Pavel Kabat will speak to this. We already know a huge amount, and we want to help translate that science into better policies so that in the next Gaidar forum in years to come, we can actually come together to take stock of what are the lessons that we're learning from implementation, from the design of the goals, from the implementation to drive faster progress. Thank you.
Thank you very much, Guido. And now I turn to Pavel Kabat, the Director General of International Institute for Applied Systems Analysis in Austria. And the particular question that I'd like to address to Pavel is, the specific feature of the Sustainable Development Goals is that it has numerical targets. And it is not only talk about what we need to do, but it also talk about numerical commitments. And that means that we have the things to measure. The question is, how far do we go with the measuring and with modeling? So what can we talk about numbers here? Please, Pavel.
Thank you, Pavel. It's an extremely symbolic moment for me and my IIASA delegation to be here today. Let's put together the best scientists from both sides of the wall. At the time, they meant Berlin Wall, to look into the problems and challenges which are too big for one single discipline, one single institution, one single country, one single economic bloc. These are the words of the former Prime Minister Alexei Kosygin and the former President of the United States Lyndon Johnson, how they founded my institution, International Institute for Applied System Analysis. To issue the mandate to address complexity, to address challenges, which are important for people, peoples, countries, despite of the geopolitical divide. How more symbolic this could be for the current challenges of trying to understand and implement development sustainable agendas. Another point of symbolism is, this is a Gaidar forum, and the former Prime Minister Gaidar was very much connected to my institution. He visited IIASA a number of times, last time 2007, and he was using this notion of understanding and committed science, for example, to develop the economic transformation agenda of this wonderful country, Russian Federation. I will start with a little story. 2002, me as a scientist, I'm from Netherlands, I was born in former Czechoslovakia, but I'm in Netherlands. I was privileged to be in Johannesburg as a part of the science advisory team to our former Crown Prince, Willem Alexander on water. And we brought their big Dutch delegation and we were discussing millennium development goals in the so-called water dome. And I remember when we were sitting there with science advisors and suddenly we look into these fantastic goals which were close to adoption about sanitation and water and poverty. And then we said, well, isn't it true that all these countries, sub-Saharan countries, for example, they are subject to enormous infrastructure gap. There is a lot of rainfall variability in these countries. Kenya, for example, can lose between two years, one of them wet, dry, 40% GDP. So we said to the political process at that time, shouldn't we think about some yet another conditional goal before we agree on sanitations and schools, namely, what kind of infrastructure we need to build on these goals? And we explained to the political process that we have a numbers, science and numbers, to look at it. We could look into Kenya and Ethiopia and Tanzania and to say, before you start to build all these schools, how much we can invest, for example, in water infrastructure. I remember very well this meeting, and we were explained at this meeting that this is true probably, but the political process already advanced too much and it was not wise to enter with such an additional comment. What happened then? We adopted goals and we are celebrating political process, we have been celebrating of achieving those goals in the countries which are subject to the investment of MDG agenda. However, when we look into the scientific underpinning of this investment, we must, and this is a really regretful statement, say that because of not considering this conditional goal, which is to build infrastructure on which this could be implemented, we have lost a large part of the investment in these goals. Let me illustrate what I mean. You and I, and all colleagues on the panel coming from the northern part of the globe, do enjoy a so-called water storage capacity at a level of 5,000 cubic meters per year to cope with floods and droughts. This is what we need in the Netherlands, United States, even in Russia, there is a high capacity. The countries like Ethiopia, Tanzania, Rwanda, these numbers are down to 20, 30, 40 cubic meters. What happens then? When there is a dry year, of course, there is a big problem with drought. When it's a wet year, there is a flood which is damaging infrastructure, starting from bridges, going down to the schools. We have done calculations to look into the way how much would it cost, how long would it take to bring this infrastructure, water infrastructure, to the level not of the US or Europe, because it's too high, to the level of South Africa, which is a sensible investment to think of, to bring it to the 800 cubic meter per capita. All the calculations we have done, we went back to the conditions of GDP growth, 5% per country, which is of country of interest of MDG, and we came up to the conclusion that it would take, for example, for Tanzania, 144 years, I'm repeating, 144 years, before they develop infrastructure on which they can build sustainable, robust investment to which the political process agrees. I think this is an illustration that the partnership of the committed science, committed institutions providing numbers to the political process is important. It is as important as Paul Polman said for the business. Business is not a stakeholder. Science doesn't want to be stakeholder. Science wants to be partner in this process because we need a continuous, robust numbers behind implementation strategies of the SDGs. We need a robust numbers behind the scenarios We need numbers which would provide safe lending intervals to invest. Let me give you yet another example. In 2006, IIASA was approached by Secretary General Ban Ki-moon with a question. Can we provide numbers behind three targets which were articulated at that time? Namely, by 2030, is it possible to have energy access across the world globally achieved? Currently, 2 billion people still don't have it, 500 million in India. Second, can we double the rate of efficiency in the energy systems? Three, can we double the rate of renewables in the energy mixes? These are three fundamental energy questions. So we collected across the world the best of the best around the IIASA models. We came with a report which was on time to adopt so-called energy for all concept, and it became the set of numbers behind SDG 7, which is probably the best numbered goal we have. And we saw that the system adopted the advice, adopted the partnership, Rio Plus 20 adopted the SDG kind of preamble, which was SC for all, and we were rather happy both on science and investment and business side. However, at that time when we produced the report, we went around, it was 2011, and we asked the CEOs of the major energy, oil and gas companies, including Rosneft and Lukoil and others, with a simple question. Can you give us the best qualified judgment how the price of oil will develop for the next 20 years, actually we said 10 years, and we said specifically, what is the lowest price you expect? Would you believe that 2011, it was December, none of the CEOs of the companies would say that the oil price per barrel will go below $80, 2011. So we did the scenarios of the competitiveness of investing in, for example, photovoltaic based on the $80 per barrel. Can you imagine what will happen to these investments when the price of oil was down to 35 or 38, which happened 3 years later? I'm trying to illustrate here that science, business, and politics partnership is another project. It's a long-term partnership that all these scenarios calculations must be continuously renewed and developed to be able to support the process. Not to claim that science has complete deterministic truth. Of course, we never have it. But science can provide, in the committed way, the way how to delineate at least the plausible, robust investment passes in this particular investment we need to make. Very important. Yet another point I would like to make, and this is an important one, Jeff already said it, but also my speakers before. I was privileged to be there in the second row when the SDG were adopted, and of course it was a big joy and big pleasure. Everybody was emotionally moved by this enormous success, as Jeff said already, to have this agenda agreed. At the same time, I knew what would happen next morning after. We start to defend our goals. We will make them sectoral. We will fight for money, compete for investment, etc., etc. This is, of course, partially true, but there is a big advantage of seeing these goals as a system, as Paul Polman said. Let me illustrate this on the example of the study which I mentioned already, Global Energy Assessment. We not only put together these scenarios for these three energy goals, but we also start to negotiate with the Secretary General team, saying the following, isn't it true that about 85% of the emission targets for the climate convention comes from energy sector? So why don't we do this study on the energy goals under the condition of 2 degree maximum warming, namely combining two sectors into the one? So every energy scenario which came up with the 2 degree target. We also said, isn't it true that energy systems, together with transport systems, are responsible up to a large extent for the global issue of the air quality problem, major megacities, like China, like everywhere. So we were allowed to enter sector three, which was all these energy scenarios will be within the compliance of the 2 degree warming max mitigation target, and also to put together scenarios which will be compliant with the WHO limit of the air quality in the major megacities. Every year, 80,000 people die attributably to the air quality problem. So we introduced 4th sector into our study, which is health, telling that all these energy scenarios and climate ones and air quality will also lead to the lowering number of people dying because of air quality by a factor of 10. We did this study, integrated study, interconnected, cross-sectoral, whatever you want to make it, and the best part comes now, when we come to the cost. Currently, we are earning altogether about 100 trillion of US dollars, roughly, which is the global GDP. If you go to invest into these energy goals, doubling efficiency, rate of renewables, and energy access. You will need to invest about 0.2% of the global GDP annually sustained for the next 30 up to 40 years. Say 200 billion a year. Remember the number. If you go for the climate convention investment, the Paris investment, 2-degree target, even not 1.5, it will be about 0.9% up to 1%, so say 900 billion a year, sustained for the next 30 years. For the air quality target, from China to Tehran, or from Tehran to Buenos Aires, it is about 600 billion, 0.6. So let's do a simple math, 0.6 plus 0.9, 1.5, plus say 1.7, 1.8% global GDP. Do you know how much would it cost if you would put these four sectors together by agreeing to invest in a systemic view of those? It will cost about 800 billion a year less, 0.8% less. This is the best illustration ever that it pays to think in systems, in decision-making, policy-making, investment, cross-sectoral, and implementation. These numbers were presented to many, many governments, the United Nations system, it was presented to the funders, and of course, they understood, but it's very hard to implement such a policies without having this partnership in place and without having institutional and governance structure which will be corresponding to this particular proposition. So it is cross-sectorality. The 17 goals, they are not separate goals, they are connected, and I think it's important to realize the economic and social advantage of investing in those based on the solid numbers coming from the committed science. I would like to end this last story because I follow three stories. And this is something which was not yet said. We are still facing, also in science, in the academic enterprise I'm representing, a kind of silo mentality, mentality which is based on the old paradigms. One of the old paradigms is sustainability, environmental agenda is the agenda which is endangering other species, which is called economic growth, which is endangering the academic purity. This is, of course, something which I hear every day. I think this is something which we need to break through. We need to introduce new paradigm, new narrative, through science, economy, policy, business partnership. Namely, sustainability transformations is a huge opportunity. Sometimes I compare this to the Manchester 1850, where we are actually facing an enormous opportunity to transform towards benefit. And what is this benefit? This benefit is reconciled benefit between the classical economic growth and environmental sustainability. This together is a real business. So that's one thing we need to think about, changing the narratives to the opportunity rather than threat, and Paul Polman said it in his speech very eloquently. The last one is about communication. I was privileged to be, and Paul knows that, member of the very high-level committee in Netherlands called Delta Committee, Fierman Committee, Paul, where we were asked, it was challenging time, beautiful time, to design Netherlands by 2100, given the challenge of water, but also other challenges. Now, it was a long story, but we did a job, and it was successful, it was adopted by Dutch Parliament, there came a law actually to place, Delta Law, which is committing Dutch government to invest 2 additional billion a year for next 100 years to the sustainable transformation centered around water. I was the lucky one who was presenting this to Dutch Parliament, so I came with my story and then I ended up, this is going to cost us 2 billion extra. And it was in 2009 after Lehman Brothers, and of course everything was about crisis. And then the most conservative right member of the parliament, I cannot say the name, but those who are Dutch understand who it is, he stood up and he said, Professor Kabat, you must be mad. You are a madman, aren't you? What the heck, what I heard. And I said, well, how much do you earn, Mr. Parliament member? And I knew it because it's so public. And so he gave me a number. And then I said, do you own the house? He said, yes. So how much is your house worth? And then he gave me a number. And then I said, can you tell me how much do you pay for all the insurance premiums from the fire all the way up? He gave me a number. And then I did my math quickly. I said, oh, wait. So you are paying like 3 up to 5% of your income to insure yourselves against all these possibilities. Do you know, Mr. XY, how much is 2 billion out of what we earn every year as a Netherlands? It's 0.05%. It's a communication. It's a communication, and I think this is something we are forgetting. I think communication must become also partner, responsible communication, examples, anecdotic evidences. So I think it's not only science and policy and business. I think we also have to have responsible media on our board, which will help us to communicate this absolutely crucial mission for our future. Thank you very much.
Thank you very much, Pavel. We have three comments from our experts. I think we are running out of time. Maybe we can get just a few sentences from each of them. And I pass the word to Svetlana Lukash, who is Russian Sherpa in G20, and what G20 does, and maybe some words about Russian priorities. Please, Svetlana.
Thank you. I will speak Russian. First of all, I would like to say that Russia pays extremely serious attention and attaches quite a lot of importance to the decisions made on sustainable development. We have actively participated in the development of the sustainable development goals, and the decision taken last year, that is the our plan 2020 and the Paris Agreement are breakthrough decisions. The world has understood that it must work as a single whole in order to avoid exhaustion of natural resources and final declaration. And as Paul Polman said, awareness is not enough. We all need engagement, and we see that business community and expert community are ready to cooperate with governments in order to achieve the goals. We believe that it is important to cooperate in the format of developed and developing countries. And the UN and the Group of 20 are extremely important platforms for this. This is a platform which brings together the leading economies of the world. And the Group of 20 agenda now reflects all the practical development goals, sustainable development goals, and contain agreements and realistic plans of action in such key areas as fighting against the poverty, fighting against various infectious diseases, food security, and provision of food, and which is most important is cooperation in the field of combating climate change and in promoting sustainable development. Last year, a plan of action of the Group of 20 was adopted to achieve the goals of the agenda 2020. That's all from me. Thank you very much. Marina Larionova, head of the center, director of the Center for Studies on International Institutions. Thank you very much. I will say a few words on the BRICS agenda, because we do need to mention the countries which account for 42% of the global population and which have a large income gap. As it has been mentioned, this gap is minimal is in Russia and Brazil four, and in South Africa is at maximum six. It is very big in China and India. And so the policy pursued on a national level is a very important for poverty reduction and achieving greater equality globally. But even more important is that the BRICS countries are working at the international, national, and local level. A good example of this is the new BRICS Bank, which began its work last year, and which now has already decided to finance seven projects. They are all within the energy centers, on renewable energy, except for one project in India for road construction. So this is an international project working at the local level in order to create new infrastructure and provide conditions for the implementation of the Sustainable Development Goal number 9, but not only. I would also like to stress that the BRICS pays a lot of attention from the very moment of its creation to development goals, sustainable development goals, but the agenda has changed very much, especially after 2015. The number of commitments has grown by 100%, so we believe that our work within the BRICS is of great importance, and we believe as BRICS partners that we should adopt national sustainable development programs, and the proposals voiced by Jeffrey for integration of specific goals would be very important and a significant event if this year they could be defined and adopted. Thank you very much. Now, Oleg Lugovoy, Research Advisor, Center for Economic Modeling of Energy and Environment. Thank you very much. I would like to thank all the participants. It has been very interesting. I would like to say a few words on the future and on the past at the same time. First of all, I would like to quote my colleague, Scott Weitner, who is here, he said once many futures are consistent with the past. That means that there are a lot of options for future development which are in harmony with the past. And here we are thinking about the future. In the 20th century, the human race has very far moved the border of production possibilities, and very successfully. But we have also approached the border of environmental possibility. And this concerns all the SDGs, it concerns water and energy and so on. So in principle, I suggest that we regard all these sustainable development goals as a single strategy for survival. There are various possibilities for future development, but not all of them, not all those alternatives or options are compatible with survival. Now the human race is developing those goals which could allow the human race to survive. And it is seen from the Paris agreements, the climate change problem, which in Russia usually is not taken seriously. If you look, for example, at the Hydrometeor Center website, we'll see that the number of extreme weather events has been growing, and most probably because of the climate change. Of course, we can discuss it, but there is the Paris Agreement, there are scientists, there is IPCC, who have reached a consensus. The risk is high, and the 190-plus countries who have signed this agreement understand it. I do not think that any of these countries is ready to sacrifice its economy to avoid climate change. This shows that all countries who have signed this see some option for the solution of this problem, and it is about technologies. If in the 20th century we develop technologies like cars, planes, and so on, now we have all of that, but now we have a choice which technologies to use. We can develop new technologies which are compatible with the humanity's survival strategy. In the 20th century, as many people lived as in all the millennia before that century. It shows that it is very important for us to consider our environmental footprint. Thank you. Thank you very much. Before ending the panel, we have a modern technology for a modern we have modern technology, and I suggest that we use it in order to take a vote. The question is, who must be the driver of achieving sustainable development? Government, private sector, civil society, or international organizations? Let me repeat it in English. In order to vote, you should press the button from 1 to 4, a button from 1 to 4 on the remote controls that you have here near your seats. So who must be the driver of the achievement of sustainable development goals? So private sector, governments, civil society, or international organizations? So you see 60% vote for the government and 30+ for civil society, despite Clyde's and Paul's wonderful presentations. So colleagues,
of course, I think that together that's quite pretty good. We get, of course, when it's a good and fair statistic, what is the most important, we get together 100% and we need it all. So I mean, in that way, everybody is correct. Together, it's 100%, and that we need, because otherwise we cannot achieve the goals. But I think that it will be the free competition also to get the percentages differently in the future, but full commitment by the governments is important. But we all here, private sector, civil society, and also our ties to the international organizations, that's the key point. That's why I was almost protesting your question, but then I thought that we get it back. Thank you.
Thank you very much, President Halonen. I close the session here, and I would like to join this position that we need to involve all the participants to get the 100%. Thank you very much.